So good afternoon, everybody, and thank you very much for joining Professor Anita Maguire from UCC and myself, Dr. Maura Hiney, from the Health Research Board for this session on developing a culture of good research practice. And we'd like to give you some national and international examples of how this is being done. But first of all, I would just like to stress what I believe to be good research practice, what that actually includes, what it looks like. So in my mind, at least, research integrity includes everything. It relates to the proposal, the preparation of it, getting ethics approval, design, making sure that it's well peer reviewed and so on and so forth. The actual doing of the research, so very much tied up with good research practice, with proper methodologies, clear performance, proper analysis and statistics and so on and so forth. And then the dissemination of the work at the end through either scientific publication or in public discourse. What are the threats to a good and positive research culture? Well, I mean, one of them is risk aversion, be that by funding agencies, the researchers themselves, or indeed their universities about perhaps blue skies research or being seen to be wrong. There is also increasing evidence that increases in competition for fewer resources, be that research funding, places in universities, tenured positions, even research positions, is increasing all the time. And that, unfortunately, is only going to get worse in our current fiscal environment. There's also been increased metricization happening over the last number of years, both at the level of the funding agencies as they assess awards for approval and in the university system where they're looking at hiring and promotion. And this has engendered some very poor practices among researchers. And a lot of researchers also feel a huge sense of lack of job security, which doesn't help their behaviour at the end of the day. Another issue that some researchers have raised is the corporatisation of universities, where they perhaps don't feel valued in and of themselves within the university ecosystem, and that the universities have become a business. So there are a lot of EU projects being done at the moment through the Science With and For Society initiative. These cover four main areas. The first is around the development of guidelines and codes of conduct. And there are a number of projects in that area, some of them looking at disease specific codes and others looking at how we might promote good practice and provide frameworks for people when they're working through guidelines and codes and their development. Another thing that the European Commission is very keen on is the creation of platforms so that there can be sharing of information across different projects, but also across stakeholder groups, be they researchers trying to develop training materials or policymakers looking for evidence. The third area of key importance for the European Union is training, and they are approaching this at many different levels, at the trainer side of things, also around institutional levels and drivers, and development of research training tools going right back to the secondary school and undergraduate students. And finally, they are very keen to encourage collaboration, and they have funded a number of different projects where they're networking networks, where they're trying to kind of ensure that there is global collaboration without, for example, ethics dumping, and where they're getting national groups together to learn from each other through mutual learning exercises. There have been three really interesting reports done in 2020 alone on research culture. LERU did a briefing paper on developing research culture within its universities. The Wellcome Trust surveyed all of its researchers about how they think research culture will work. And the UK Research and Innovation Agency have also done a very interesting report. So what were the key findings from these reports? Because these really were coming from the researchers' perspective. Well, what they found was that if the researchers felt valued, if they felt secure in their jobs, if they felt supported by their PIs, by their mentors, by their departments, by their universities, and that they had a sense of autonomy, they were better able to withstand the slings and arrows of the challenges I talked about around competition and so on and so forth. Also, that local culture can really strongly influence behaviour, and that can actually override institutional and national policies. So that goes to show how important local culture is. And that the systematic pressures and perverse incentives that we see in the system are very deeply embedded. So that means basically that it's going to be very difficult to change, but that you can do this through a culture of continuous improvement and recognizing that nobody is alone in this, that everybody has a part to play in changing the system. So there's been a really interesting paper recently published through one of the EU projects, SOPs for RI, and they looked at 9 ways that you might be able to move from talking about research integrity to actually walking the walk of changing the culture. And they gave many different examples of how you might do this. One was through the creation of data champions, for example, at the University of Delft. A lot of universities were looking at better ways to assess researchers that is more oriented towards quality rather than quantity. Some universities, for example, the University of Glasgow, actually include collegiality as a criterion now for promotion to professorship. Most universities have introduced mandatory training of some sort at all levels. The University of Luxembourg, for example, has introduced research integrity coaches. And a lot of universities are now trying to get the researchers involved in developing institutional policies. And also there are some really good examples of recognising good practice in research integrity, in data management and so on. So at this point, I'll hand you over to Professor Anita Maguire, who talks specifically about the Irish situation. Anita.
Thank you very much, Maura. I'm delighted to have an opportunity to give you some insight into initiatives which are being undertaken here in Ireland to support the development of a positive culture for research right across our research system. And I suppose central to this was the establishment of the Research Integrity National Forum in 2015. I've had the honour of chairing it since that time, together with my very able Deputy Chair, Dr. Jennifer Brennan from THEA. But I suppose the most important element of the Research Integrity National Forum is that it brings together all of the various elements in the research ecosystem. So the funders are there, the research performing organisations and all of the other stakeholder organisations which form part of an ecosystem. So it's an ideal location to talk through and to share experiences as everybody is on the journey to ensure that they continue to develop the research and culture within their own organisation. And it's that shared participation which really makes a difference in the long term. I suppose many of the members of the forum have participated in international research integrity organisations. Maura has been the vice chair of NREO. Myself and Jennifer have both participated in the mutual learning exercise at European level. And we were also participants on the EUA working group on research ethics and integrity. So the forum provides a national centre point which can be seen as speaking for the Irish research system. And I suppose the role of the forum is that we were tasked with oversight of research integrity across the ecosystem, but specifically tasked with the actions which were embedded in the National Research and Integrity Research and Innovation Strategy. And we report annually to the Strategy Implementation Group. And the fact that our work was embedded in Innovation 2020 was very helpful to us in bringing forward the initiatives that we wanted to develop and ensuring the visibility of the work of the forum across the system. And I suppose in the first couple of years of the forum, we recognised that provision of training across the research system was a key priority. When you're trying to change the culture within a research performing system, that whole idea of training people and bringing them with you on the journey is a key element. Next slide there. So in terms of the training, we were absolutely adamant that we would have a minimum level of training available to everybody across the research system, whether they were in one of the larger RPOs or in a small RPO, that everybody had access to a basic minimum level training. And there was a tremendous partnership put in place, which was underwritten by the research funders with a contribution from the IUA and THEA. But together we developed a national shared service, which made the EPIGEM training available across the system to all research performing agencies from January 2018 for 3 years. So we had access for 15,000 users over those 3 year periods, and by June of this year over 11,000 researchers had accessed and undertaken the training, which is really a very significant input relative to the amount of training which was in place before the introduction of this system. And one of the most positive elements of this training scheme was that in addition to the early career researchers researchers, the PhD students and the postdocs, there was a very high level of uptake among the PI community of this training. And I think that's a really important element of when you're trying to change the culture, making sure that the established researchers also participate and also understand what's the current best practice in terms of the conduct of research. So we had a remarkably successful rollout of this across the research system, and you know, ensuring that that was available across all organisations, independent of the scale of that activity. Now, we all recognise that that basic online training, it provides a basic training, but it's not the beginning and the end of training people in terms of the good conduct and research. It's an essential foundation, but it's very important that each individual organisation builds on that in other ways, having direct contact, workshops and other engagements. And what I'd like to share with you is the thinking that we've had in University College Cork and how we've embedded this training as part of a larger system of altering the culture in the conduct of research in University College Cork. Next slide, please. So I suppose it's very important to consider this from the researcher perspective. 99% of PIs want their research to be done to the very highest standards. People are committed to conducting their research to the highest standard possible. But we need to remember that for the PIs, there are so many demands on their time in terms of compliance and in terms of the various elements they have to manage to ensure their research is done effectively. There really is an onus on the research system and on the RPOs to ensure that we provide them with the tools and the supports they need, that as they're leading and mentoring their research team, that it's easy for them to build this whole idea of a culture of good conduct of research into their day-to-day lives. We need to work with them. We need to recognize the various demands that they are on. But our PIs have so many aspects that they need to keep in the air that even for those with the best of intentions, they need the support of the system to enable them to develop this. Next slide, please, Maura. And what we did in the university in UCC was we very much realized that, you know, this is much more than a training process whereby you take an early career researcher, you put them through a training process, you tick the box, and suddenly everything is fine. Developing a good conduct of research is a much more nuanced and a much more long-term engagement with researchers. And we made sure that every step we took made it very clear to people that this isn't just something which you do when you tick a box and it's completed, that it really is about a journey and it's about developing a local environment within the institutions so that the good conduct of research is the normal part of everyday life. We also recognise that while there needs to be a good culture at the RPO level, people's experience of their research life is actually totally dominated by the local environment within their research team or within their school or within their centre. So when you're working at an institution level, you need to filter it down and make sure that experience is actually lived by the individuals who work within individual research teams. And that communication down through organisations is much more difficult than it seems when you're talking about cultural issues. And we need to recognise that researchers' experience is dominated by the experience within their own team. At the outset of this journey, we used the Fulbright Exchange Programme to bring over Phil DeShang and Bob Dooling from the University of Maryland, both of whom have a lot of experience in embedding a good culture of research within their university system. And they spent quite a bit of time here in Ireland. They travelled around to other institutions as well. And they were very open in sharing the journey that they'd taken along this journey. And that was very helpful to us in UCC as we formulated our thinking on how you best embed these principles within the day-to-day operation of the research community. Next slide, Maura. So what we did in UCC was we recognised that the Epigeum programme forms an excellent foundation, but in itself, you know, it's a foundation that brings people a certain part of a journey, but you really need to enrich and embed that as part of a larger experience. And one of the things that we were particularly concerned about was that the experience of good conduct and research isn't about what early career researchers do. It's about what a whole research team does, right from the most senior PI who leads a research institute the PIs within that research institute, the experienced postdoctoral researchers, the PhD students, and indeed the undergraduate students who may work in the research teams from time to time, and also the support research with staff within those environments. So what we did was, instead of training these people separately, we developed a blended programme where we brought all of the people in an institute together. So I brought my own team, you know, I was there as the director of an institute, then all of the PIs on the team were there, the postdocs, the PhD students, and we spent 2 half days on workshops where we actually discussed really tricky issues, you know, those grey areas that come up when you talk about what's right and what's wrong. We talked through all of those areas. And of course, what we were really doing there was giving the early career researchers the language, the knowing when something happened that they were uncomfortable, how do they articulate those concerns? And the fact that it was okay to talk about those with the senior management in the area. The shared experience spanning the whole range of career experience to us was a central element of this. And I think for many of the senior PIs who were present, they realized that while they might have felt they knew everything about this area, when it came to the details of talking about some of these difficult issues, they all still had something to learn in those areas. And then in addition, we had a workshop on data management, talking through how you manage your data, how you store your data. And we tailor that very much, depending on which research team we were going into, we tailor that story to match their own needs in terms of data management. And we had a workshop on reproducibility, again, sharing, tailoring that towards the needs of the individual group. And then at the end of that, the researchers were asked to feedback in terms of a reflective exercise. So they drew all of the strengths in the workshops on the conduct of the misconduct, the reproducible research and the data management, and they fed back a reflective exercise on those. And when they've completed all of those, then they were awarded a digital badge, which they can use and which gives them a micro-credential showing that they've achieved a certain proficiency in this area. But for me, the really important element of this is that the whole group sits together and talks about these issues so that the day something arises, the group is confident talking about these issues collectively. And I think that's the part which makes a difference in the long run. Could have the next slide, please, Maura. So we were delighted that this digital badge program has been highlighted in a number of areas. So you can see here Epigeum highlighted the way in which we embedded their online training within this larger blended workshop program method. And this is available online. It describes the philosophy of the course and also the way in which we implemented it. The next slide, Maura. And indeed, we were delighted that this digital badge program was highlighted in the article that Maura mentioned earlier, where they called it out as an example of good practice in this area. Next slide, Maura. I suppose finally, what I would say is developing the research culture in an institution, this isn't something which happens overnight. This is a long, slow process which requires a lot of commitment from the senior leadership within organisations to ensure that time is carved out to deliver this. But it also requires partnership between the RPOs and also the funders and the policy stakeholders. Everybody needs to work together to ensure that the researchers prioritise this area and ensure that they align their efforts in terms of focusing on creating the appropriate culture for their research. In the long term, the time that we all take in creating this type of environment is well worth the effort invested, but this isn't something that can be done just on a very simple basis. Even with the digital badges that we have developed, it's a very, very good model, and we've probably trained, you know, a couple of hundred people within UCC, but it only works when you have 30 or 40 people in a room. It's not something that you can scale easily, and it takes that time and effort. So I think it's important to remember, for quality change of this culture, this isn't something which can be done easily, but every step along the journey has a lasting impact, and I think that's worth remembering. Next slide, Maura. So finally, I'm delighted to have had the opportunity to share this with you. I'm very happy to discuss this further if anybody has any further questions. But hopefully the examples that Maura and I have shared with you will inspire you to consider how people can work together to ensure that we all deliver the best possible research culture across the ecosystem. Thank you.